All right, thank you guys once again for coming to the weekly Bible study centered on the Dead Sea Scroll faith. This week we decided to study the Genesis Apocryphon, which was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So I'm going to be going through that this week and hopefully covering the entire thing. I'm not sure if I'll be able to, but that will be my intention, to try to cover it all. So basically, the Genesis Apocryphon, there was only one copy of it found. It was found in the first cave. There were 11 caves of the Dead Sea Scrolls. In the first cave, that was the first one they discovered in 1948, one of those scrolls was named later on by the scholars the Genesis Apocryphon. That was one of the hardest scrolls to open. It was much more fragmentary and vulnerable to damage, and it was sealed in a more difficult way. I think there was wax, like, or some type of sealant that made it hard to open, and they didn't want to open it and break it really badly. So what these scholars try to do when things like this happen is they try to figure out a way to open it by doing the least amount of damage to the scroll. And that's what they eventually did with this Genesis Apocryphon scroll. Unfortunately, because of the process of time and the nature of that particular scroll, it was not the best preserved, so there's a lot of fragments missing, or portions of the scroll are eaten away, either by bugs or just by decay over time. We have portions of the scroll missing, so that makes it a fragmentary condition. Despite that, what is preserved is very mind-blowing and influential. If you accept the authenticity of these writings, it changes so much and proves a lot of things. Even though we have it in fragments, we can prove a lot of doctrines from this idea. So, Sean, do you have the PDF file? If you can, if you don't have it yet, go to deadseascrollslibrary.wordpress.com and then go to the Genesis Apocryphon link and download it from there, because we're going to be going through that, studying it together. So, there were three different books found in the Genesis Apocryphon. You know how, like, the Law of Moses. The Law of Moses is five different books, but sometimes scribes put the five books of Moses together in one scroll. Because even though they're different books, they're all part of the same theme, and they're a continuous thread, so they put the five books of the law together. In the same way, this is what happened with the Genesis Apocryphon. There were multiple books of the patriarchs, the forefathers, which the scribe, whoever was copying this out, put those books together. These scholars ignorantly believe that there was only one author of the Genesis Apocryphon, but we who accept the Genesis Apocryphon as scripture know that's not true. We know that it was written by different authors, who they claim to be written by. And so there's three books we can identify based on the content, and the first one is the Book of Lamech, written by Lamech himself, the father of Noah. Then there is a Book of Noah, which was found, and this was claims to be written by Noah. And then finally, Book of Abraham comes after, and that claims to be written by Abraham. Unfortunately, the rest of Abraham is missing. According to the scholars, someone cut it off in ancient times, the rest of the scroll, and separated it. Perhaps it was because it was a really long scroll, and they couldn't keep it in one place, so they cut it in half so they could separate it to make it easier to carry or hide. And so the second half, we don't know where that is. And the beginning of the Genesis Apocryphon is also missing. But there's, at the top of the pages, or not pages, but columns, the scroll had columns. And at the top of the columns of the scroll, it has a special marker using the Hebrew alphabet. Every sheet, there's a sheet, which contains like 5 to 7 columns in each sheet. And on the sheet, it'll have a Hebrew letter. Then the next sheet, it has the next Hebrew letter. And the next sheet has the next Hebrew letter. And it's in alphabetical order. What we see is that I think it started with Kof, which is near the end of the Hebrew alphabet, which means that we're actually missing a good chunk of the beginning part of the Genesis Apocryphon. So there was the book of Lamech. It was probably much larger than what we have. And then there was probably another book before that about Adam and his generations, which is completely gone, which almost certainly preceded that. So we can't study what we didn't find, but we're going to study what we have found in this scroll. So I'm going to turn there. Hold on. You see here. I need to reopen that. I must have closed it. So what I did when going through this teaching, I mean, not this teaching, but going through and studying these books, I used my knowledge of the scriptures to try to fill in some of the missing parts, only on certain occasions. So in certain places, I believe I have been able to restore the text almost entirely of what it said in the original. In other places, I have not been able to do that yet. And so I'll point out to you those places. But the PDF file that you guys will follow along with is not mine. It's not what I did. It's someone else's translation, a scholar's translation. So that scholar's translation has everything there is what was found in the fragments. You're going to hear me read some things, which is my attempt to restore some missing parts. And I'll let you know when that is so that you're not deceived into thinking something was found which wasn't, okay? The reason I tried to reconstruct it is because the Book of Jubilees and the Book of Genesis both are linked to this writing, the Genesis Apocryphon. And so we can use Jubilees and Genesis to fill in some of those missing portions. Doing that enables us to give us a context for the narrative of these writings. Because otherwise, you just have fragments here and there, and it's hard to get a good story or a good understanding of what's being said. So please turn to, let's see here, it should say page 50 in the PDF file of 349, yeah, page 50 of 349, and in the actual PDF file, you'll see a numbers at the top, and it'll be page 31. So it's page 31 in the PDF, the actual book, but it's page 50 in that PDF file. So when you go there, it starts off, hold on one second. It's frozen right now. Hold on. One second. Frustrating. Sorry, people. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on, people. I'm sorry. It's freezing up for me right now. Ugh. Hold on. Okay. Can you guys hear me? My apologies. My entire Gmail, or not Gmail, my Google, I had everything in Google Chrome and it completely crashed. My computer did not crash, but
The browser just stopped working. So my apologies for that. The files up. So are you guys all there? Did you hear the page number that I told you guys to turn? It was, I think it was page. And okay, good. Good. Yeah, I opened up Internet Explorer to do this. Okay, so starting on page 50, let me get to it. Okay. You're gonna see on every page, there's the top of the page in Aramaic. It's actually Aramaic, it's not Hebrew. The original was in Hebrew. But the copy that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls is an Aramaic copy. So you'll see the Aramaic text that was found, and then you'll see the translation of the scholar there. Yeah, 50, and it'll say page 31. So first of all, it begins in the middle of the book of Lamech, and it has the angels. Or the righteous angels talking, I think. Or no, wait. No, it's this time it's the sinful watchers are talking, and they're lamenting their fate. Like at the bottom of that page in the text, you'll see it says, "And now we are prisoners." And it says near the top, it says that in every way we might undertake an adulterous act. So this is describing some more information from the perspective of the watchers. Okay. Then we go to the next page. Hold on. Okay, yeah, so on page 51 now, which is page 32, you see again it says in line 13, you see, because he ceased his words at the time of our imprisonment. So they're talking about themselves still, our imprisonment. And one of the What's very interesting in the Enoch writings and in these ancient writings, you'll see the Lord of the Ages, or here they translate it as Lord of Eternity. There's also Lord of Heaven. You see that term in line 11. You see the Great Holy One. That's a very common Enoch term all throughout the Book of Enoch. You'll see that. Now, in column 1, it's an account of what they did, how they descended and mated with woman. It says we're descending and with the woman. And then on the next page, right now at the beginning, I'm only giving you a couple parts here because it's more fragmentary. So we can't glean as much. But now it looks like, let's see here. Now it seems to change to God talking, and possibly the angels talking too, the righteous angels. And in line nine, it corresponds with Enoch of where it talks about the things that the sinful watchers taught the earth, the people of the earth. They taught them the sorceries, divinations, special medicines that they could use. Yeah, Enoch chapter 6. And you can see from chapter 6 all the way to chapter 12, I think, or chapter 11, it has some information about what the watchers did, their sins. And so all this is just really connecting with the Enoch literature. Now, I did a teaching on the Book of Lamech a long time ago, sometime last year, and... Oh, that's really good. I'm glad people are coming and open to hearing these things. It's really amazing information. And so, yeah, it's basically I did a teaching before, like a year or two ago, on about the dogs in the background. Just ignore the noise. My apologies. But so I did a teaching on the Lamech scroll, just the Lamech portion, not the Noah or the Abraham one. And I did a lot more preparation and detailed insight on, like, line by line. We don't have time to do line by line like that, so I'm just going more of a quicker overview in this teaching. Wait, hold on one second. Yeah.
Did she ever go out?
Yeah. Okay. So... Yeah, my apologies. I'm living with other people, so sometimes it makes it difficult, but I don't think there'll be any more interruptions. So, all right, so now I want you guys to go to page 53, okay? It'll say at the top 34, and you're going to see there a strong bond, it says in line 21. The strong bond refers to the bond that the Watchers made. They made a special pact to sin and sleep with the women. And the question was, is this in the Book of Enoch? It corresponds to the Book of Enoch, but this is not from the Book of Enoch. This is from the Book of Lamech. The father of Noah is writing this, and that's what we're reading from. It's fragmentary in the beginning, though. Now, you'll see right here it says, "The Lord and by messenger," this is line 25, "the Lord and by messengers he sent to you," and then 26, "to the earth and to go down to strengthen the people." Line 27, "what to do, mankind to the earth." Now, what is this talking about? There's a special teaching that's not mentioned in the Book of Enoch, but which is mentioned in Jubilees, and that is that it actually says in Jubilees that when the Watchers descended, they did not descend to sin. That was not their original reason for coming down. They actually came down to help teach mankind righteousness, and that's what this Book of Lamech is talking about right here. So let me read that one part from Jubilees. It says, let's see. So here's what it says, and in Jubilees, chapter 4, verse 15. "And in the second week of the 10th Jubilee, Mahalalel took unto him to wife Dinah, the daughter of Barachiel, the daughter of his father's brother. And she bare him a son in the third week in the sixth year. And he called his name Jared. For in his days the angels of the Lord descended on the earth, those who are named the Watchers, that they should instruct the children of men, and that they should do judgment and uprightness on the earth." So that's the original story. They actually descended to teach righteousness. Okay, and that's what Lamech is telling us here.
where he says, the Lord, and by messengers he sent to you, and then to the earth, and to go down to strengthen the people, what to do, mankind to the earth. So, the Lamech scroll just gives so much greater depth. Now, unfortunately, we have some missing text again, but then in the next column, it preserves a lot, and we have a parallel account. This parallel account enables us to fill in some of the missing portions. So before we read through this, so it's going to be page 35, okay? Before we're going to go through that, though, I'm going to read from the Book of Enoch the relevant passages connecting. It's near the end of the Book of Enoch. So it starts out in chapter 106 of the Book of Enoch. It says, this is being written by Enoch. He says, and after some days, my son Methuselah took a wife for his son Lamech, and she became pregnant by him and bore a son. And his body was white as snow and red as the blooming of a rose. And the hair of his head and his long locks were white as wool. And his eyes beautiful. And when he opened his eyes, he lighted up the whole house like the sun. And the whole house was very bright. And thereupon he arose in the hands of the midwife, opened his mouth, and conversed with the Lord of Righteousness. And his father Lamech was afraid of him, and fled, and came to his father Methuselah. And he said unto him, I have begotten a strange son, diverse from and unlike man, and resembling the sons of the God of heaven. And his nature is different, and he is not like us. And his eyes are as the rays of the sun, and his countenance is glorious. And it seems to me that he is not sprung from me, but from the angels. And I fear that in his days a wonder may be wrought on the earth. And now, my father, I am here to petition thee and implore thee that thou mayest go to Enoch our father and learn from him the truth, for his dwelling place is amongst the angels. And when Methuselah heard the words of his son, he came to me to the ends of the earth, for he had heard that I was there. And he cried aloud, and I heard his voice, and I came to him. And I said unto him, behold, here am I, my son, wherefore hast thou come to me? And he answered and said, because of a great cause of anxiety have I come to thee, and because of a disturbing vision have I approached. And now, my father, hear me. Unto Lamech my son there hath been born a son, the like of whom there is none. And his nature is not like man's nature, and the color of his body is whiter than snow and redder than the bloom of a rose. And the hair of his head is whiter than white wool, and his eyes are like the rays of the sun. And he opened his eyes, and thereupon lighted up the whole house. And he arose in the hands of the midwife, and opened his mouth, and blessed the Lord of heaven. And his father Lamech became afraid, and fled to me, and did not believe that he was sprung from him, but that he was in the likeness of the angels of heaven. And behold, I have come to thee, that thou mayest make known to me the truth. And I, Enoch, answered and said unto him, so this again, this is still from the Book of Enoch, it's a parallel passage. So Enoch answers him and says, the Lord will do a new thing on the earth, and this I have already seen in a vision, and make known to thee that in the generation of my father Jared, some of the angels of heaven transgressed the word of the Lord. And behold, they commit sin and transgress the law, and have united themselves with women, and commit sin with them, and have married some of them, and have begot children by them. And they shall produce on the earth giants, not according to the spirit, but according to the flesh. And there shall be a great punishment on the earth, and the earth shall be cleansed from all impurity. Yea, there shall come a great destruction over the whole earth, and there shall be a deluge and a great destruction for 1 year. And this son who has been born unto you shall be left on the earth, and his three children shall be saved with him. When all mankind that are on the earth shall die, he and his son shall be saved. And now make known to thy son Lamech that he who has been born is in truth his son, and call his name Noah, for he shall be left to you, and he and his son shall be saved from the destruction which shall come upon the earth, on account of all the sin and all the unrighteousness which shall be consummated on the earth in his days. And after that there shall be still more unrighteousness than that which was first consummated on the earth. For I know the mysteries of the holy ones, for he the Lord has showed me and informed me, and I have read them in the heavenly tablets. And chapter 107 of Enoch is much shorter, like 3 verses. And it says, "And I saw written on them that generation upon generation shall transgress till a generation of righteousness arises, and transgression is destroyed, and sin passes away from the earth, and all manner of good comes upon it. And now, my son, go and make known to thy son Lamech that this son which has been born is in truth his son, and that this is no lie." And when Methuselah had heard the words of his father Enoch, for he had shown to him everything in secret, he returned and showed them to him, and called the name of that son Noah, for he will comfort the earth after all the destruction. So that's the account from Enoch's perspective. Before the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, the scholars said this is a fragment from the, or a portion of the Book of Noah. But this scroll that was found proves that's not true. But rather, it's not from the Book of Noah. It's a condensed version that Enoch wrote, summarizing the story of Lamech, the Book of Lamech that Lamech, the father of Noah, wrote. And so we're going to go through now in the Genesis Apocryphon, and we're going to see how it corresponds with what we read. Since the Book of Enoch corresponds and preserves the same storyline, we can use those chapters to fill in some of the missing portions. And that's what I've done. So while I'm reading from my reconstructed version that I did, please follow along in the PDF file. And you'll see how the way I reconstructed it fits very well with the context of the Book of Lamech and of the Book of Enoch. So, let's see here. Second. Okay. So here's what I have reconstructed. I have the first, I have like five lines before column two, which I'm going to read for you guys what I said. So basically, see on page 54, see where it says column two, line one? I'm going to read I was asked to upload the link, but that might take a while, or in other words, it might interrupt the teaching to load it, but I can share with you guys after if you'd like to see. So just try to follow along in the PDF that you guys have that I shared with you guys, and I'll just let you know the parts that I've reconstructed. So column two, line one, that's where the scroll starts there. I filled in about five or six lines prior to give context based on my studies of this scroll. So here's how I introduce this section. I say, "My father Methuselah reported Enoch's words unto me, and afterwards I went unto Berechiah, my uncle, and asked of him his daughter Betanus, that she might be a wife unto me, and he gave her to me. And I went in unto her and knew her, and she loved me in the heat of intercourse, and I could hear the gasping of her breath in her breast, and sharing with her sexual pleasure was heavenly. And thus she conceived and became pregnant. And when the time of her labor came, she gave birth, and out came a child of disturbing appearance. His appearance was like an angel. His body was white as snow, and red as the blooming of a rose, and the hair of his head, and his long locks, were white as wool, and his eyes beautiful. And when he opened his eyes, light shone from his eyes, and he lighted up the entire house like the light of the sun, and the whole house was very bright. And her son was being held in the hands of the midwife, but he suddenly arose from her hands, and opened his mouth, and began to praise the Lord and speak to him as a son speaks to a father." That was my reconstructed part. Now here we start in the actual, this column, where you'll follow along. But there's missing portions, so I fill in some of those missing portions too. So just see, read as I read, and you'll see the parts that I'm adding. So it says, "Then suddenly it occurred to me that the conception was from watchers, and the seed from holy ones, and to fallen ones did he belong. And my mind wavered concerning the infant. Then I, Lamech, was upset. So I approached Betanus, my wife, and I said to her, I fear I am not the child's father. Now I adjure thee by the Most High, by the mighty Lord, by the King of all ages,
to tell me whether thou hast conceived by one of the sons of heaven, that thou recount truthfully everything for me, whether thou hast sinned against me or not. Thou must recount truthfully for me without lies. The son from thee is unique, unlike any of the sons of men. I adjure thee, by the King of all ages, that thou wilt speak truthfully with me, without lies. Then Bathinos, my wife, spoke with me very harshly, and wept exceedingly, and beat her breasts, and was deeply cut to the heart. And she said, O my brother and my husband, recall for thyself my sexual pleasure that I shared with thee, and remember my love in the heat of intercourse, and the gasping of my breath in my breast. I am telling thee everything truthfully, and thou shouldst believe everything I say to thee entirely. Then my mind wavered greatly within me. Now when Bathinos, my wife, saw that my demeanor had changed because of my exceeding anger against her for speaking harshly to me, then she suppressed her anger and spoke with me, saying to me, O my husband and my brother, remember our union and recall my pleasure. I swear to thee by the great Holy One, by the King of heaven, that I am not lying, but I am speaking truthfully, that this seed is from thee, and from thee this conception, and from thee the planting of this fruit. My son was truly born from thee, and not from any stranger, nor from any of the watchers, nor from any of the sons of heaven. Why is the shape and appearance of thy face changed and contorted like this, and thy spirit wavering upon thee like this? I promise thee by oath that I am not lying, but I am speaking truthfully with thee. Then I, Lamech, ran to Methuselah, my father, and told him everything that happened, and I begged him to help me and go to Enoch, his father, in order to learn everything from him with certainty, since he is a beloved one and a friend of God, and with the holy ones is his lot apportioned, for they make everything known to him. When Methuselah heard what I spake unto him, and saw my grief, he ran to Enoch his father to learn everything truthfully from him, so that whatever he should say we should act according to his will. And he went through the length of the land of Paravim, and there he found the ends of the earth, and called out to Enoch. And he said to Enoch his father, O my father and my lord, I have come to thee for the controversy of my son, and that thou shouldst reveal the truth to me. And I say to thee, do not be angry that I came here to seek thee about earthly matters, for I know thy great prominence, and I am fearful of thee, my father. So I'll stop there for a second. So you can see how some of the parts were missing that I read and I filled in, but that my reconstruction is faithful to the context and the spirit of this writing. But so basically, what's really amazing about this is when we compare the Book of Lamech with the Book of Enoch about the same section, everything I just read, almost that entire thing, is not in the Book of Enoch. Book of Enoch basically just says Lamech doubted about his son and went to Methuselah. It doesn't have anything about how he talked with his wife and how they went back and forth and how she was upset with him and he was upset with her and their discussion about this. This entire thing is a completely extra information that we're missing from Enoch's account. So that's very significant that what we see there is this is the original version of the story, and Enoch just made a shorter version, a summary account. And we saw that because Noah was born very gloriously. He looked like an angel. He was shining, and he was talking as a baby. If any of you saw a baby talking after just being born, you would think, what in the world is this? This must be, is this demonic or something? What's going on here? That's what Lamech was, he was confused because this was very abnormal. And they had seen the children of the Watchers, what they looked like. And those children looked glorious and very beautiful. And so when he saw Noah looked very similar to the Watchers' children. So he started to doubt about his wife and said, this has to be, I don't believe this is my own son, because how could this be? If it was my own son, he wouldn't look so heavenly like this. He looked heavenly. And so Lamech did not believe her, but she was swearing, and he knew, okay, she's promising this is, and she's swearing by the King of all ages, by the Great Holy One. and so by the Most High. And that's a serious thing to do. So he realized, okay, well, I got to give her a chance. And even though I'm really skeptical about this, I'll give her that chance. And I'm going to, I know that Enoch will know, because Enoch knows everything. Enoch is with the angels. The angels reveal to him the secrets, the mysteries. He knew that Enoch was a very prominent man and prophet. And so he had his father go to him, because Methuselah knew where his father was. Lamech did not know. So Methuselah went on behalf of his son Lamech. Lamech was the son of Methuselah, and Methuselah was the son of Enoch. So Lamech is the grandson of Enoch, and Noah is the great-grandson. So, and his wife, Lamech's wife, was trying to plead with her husband and saying, remember the pleasure that we have. Basically saying, don't you remember, we did this. You slept with me, and I assure you, you're the only one I slept with. I know for certain that you are a father. Please believe me. So she was trying to appeal to his own memory and experience. And let's see here. And what's very amazing is that in the Book of Jubilees, it says that Lamech's wife was named Batinos. In no other writing, no other book of scripture says that that was Lamech's wife's name. But in Jubilees it says it, and in the Book of Lamech it says it here. Batinos, which means daughter of man or daughter of a mortal man. It's Enosh, the word Enosh, which is used in Hebrew to refer to men who are capable of dying. And so that's a connection here. And we're going to see all throughout this that Jubilees connects in so many ways with this Genesis Apocryphon that no other books connect. And so it's clearly indicating that Jubilees is based on these other writings. Jubilees was using these writings as its source material. Now, there was a, let's see here, in the PDF file, we're going to go to what I read is all the way, brings us all the way down to page 56. So please turn to page 56. And you're going to see where it says lines 27 to 36 are missing. As I said, it's fragmentary. So we're missing those lines. I filled those lines in using the Book of Enoch, and there was another fragment found, this time in Hebrew, it was not Aramaic, Cave 1. In Cave 1 there was a fragment found which seems very, it seems from what I could study of that fragment that it has to be from this book. And so I'm going to read my reconstruction of that fragment. Let's see here. All that fragment says, I'll read to you first what the fragment says, and then I'll tell you my reconstruction. So it says, "We're astonished. A firstborn son had been born, which was glorious. His father. And when Lamech saw the rooms of the house like rays of the sun," and then there's a word, "afraid." All that's found on a Hebrew fragment. This is not a fragment of Enoch, because when we look at the Enoch section, it does not match what it said there on that fragment. And when we see here, it refers to Lamech in the third person. So the only way this can be is if it's someone else talking about Lamech. Because remember, Lamech is using in the first person. He refers to himself. I, he says, and me. But in this fragment that was found in Hebrew, in that first cave, it says third person, "and when Lamech saw." So this has to be from a conversation about Lamech. And this, based on the context, is Methuselah's words to Enoch. So I'm going to read that reconstruction now. "So I left off saying, 'Fearful of thee, my father.'" And now I continue with the reconstruction. "And Enoch heard the voice of his son calling out to him, and he left his abode and appeared to him, and he said, 'Behold, here I am, my son. Wherefore hast thou come to me?' And Methuselah said, 'Because of a great cause of anxiety have I come to thee, and because of a disturbing vision.' And now, my father, hear me. The wife of my son Lamech conceived and became pregnant, and she gave birth to a child the like of whom there is none. And his nature is not like man's nature, and the color of his body is whiter than snow, and redder than the bloom of a rose, and the hair of his head is whiter than white wool. They were astonished, and in great fear of the child, because a firstborn son had been born, which was glorious in his appearance. But Lamech was exceedingly fearful, and did not believe that he was his father. And when Lamech saw the child open his eyes, light filled all the rooms of the house like rays of the sun. Then the child arose in the hands of the midwife, and opened his mouth, and blessed the Lord of heaven. And his father Lamech became afraid and fled to me, and did not believe that he was sprung from him, but that he was in the likeness of the angels of heaven. And he said unto me, My father, I have begotten a strange son, diverse from an unlike man, and resembling the sons of the gods of heaven, and his nature is different, and he is not like us, and his eyes are as the rays of the sun, and his countenance is glorious. It seems to me that he is not sprung from me, but from the angels, and I fear that in his days a wonder may be wrought on the earth. And now, my father, I am here to petition thee, and I implore thee that thou mayest go to Enoch our father, and learn from him the truth, for his dwelling place is amongst the angels, and so I have come. So now, that was my reconstruction of the missing section. Now we go to the PDF file, and you'll see at the top it'll say, or not the top, at the bottom of that page of 56, you'll see it says all, and then it says, and not for the length, and for in the days of Jared my father. Oh yeah, in the line before, it says not, just one word, not. So I also tried to reconstruct a little bit of that too. So I'll read that. Here's what I said. It said, And Enoch answered him, The things of this earth will not last forever, but the Lord will do a new thing on the earth, for all shall be renewed, but not for the length of many days. This I have already seen in a vision, and make known to thee, for in the days of Jared my father, some of the angels of heaven transgressed the word of the Lord. And behold, they committed sin and transgressed the law, and dwelt the sons of God with women. And they begot children by them, and shall become giants, not according to the spirit, but according to the flesh, and they will remain on the earth until the day of wrath comes. These sons of angels, the giants, will sin greatly, and imitate the iniquity of their wicked fathers, and they will be for you a plague and a curse. And a great punishment will befall the houses of mankind, and upon the earth, and upon all that is in it, and there shall be a purging of all impurity. Yea, there shall come a great destruction that will last 1 year, and a deluge it will be over all the earth. The flood waters will come and will wash away all the sinners that dwell in your land and that dwell in my land. For this sea shall cover the entire world. But God will replant all the creatures of the earth. He will place all of it as one fruit. The earth will be repopulated through the chosen one, and he shall refill through an ark the earth, and in it he shall call his people. Now then go and report these words to thy son Lamech, and be assured that all these things I speak to thee truthfully, that without lies I have revealed them to thee. That's all I was able to reconstruct there. I was using from the book of Enoch, that parallel section, to reconstruct some of that. The rest of, for a long while, I can't reconstruct almost anything, because it doesn't have a parallel with what's preserved in the book of Enoch. So in other words, this book of Lamech preserves the same story, but there's so much extra stuff that's not in the book of Enoch. So it was a much longer story that we just have a short version of it in the book of Enoch. So before you turn to page 57, see where it says, For in the days of Jared my father, in line 3? That corresponds with the book of Enoch, the exact wording in, let me see here, it was in verse 13 of chapter 106, it says, In the generation of my father Jared. So in the generation of my father Jared, or in the days of my father Jared, it's the same thing. So it's an indication here that it's clearly the same account, it's just in a much larger version in this Genesis Apocryphon scroll, this book of Lamech. So now go to page 57, And I'm going to, now I'm not going to read from my reconstructed version. I'm just going to read from the PDF file that you guys are following along with. So you'll see it says in line 15 says, reaches as a spring too. That's probably talking about the flood, how the waters, where the waters reach. And then you'll see it says, he is the one who will divide the entire earth. And with, that's referring to Noah. That's a prophecy of Noah. Because later on in the Genesis Apocryphon and in Jubilees, Noah is the one who allots the earth to each of his sons, his three sons. The entire earth is divided. Remember in Genesis it says, in the days of Peleg, the earth was divided. The earth being divided is referring to this Noah dividing it between his sons for an inheritance, which will be discussed later in the teaching. So this is Enoch's prophecy about this going to be happening. Now you'll see in line 18, it says vacat. You're going to see that a lot throughout the book. Vacat is a Latin word, and it just means blank. And what that means is in that scroll that was found, you know how in regular books of the Bible, in modern copies, you have paragraph indentations, and then like it's you end a section, and even if it doesn't finish a whole line, you don't finish the rest of the line because you finish a topic, and then you move to the next one. It's just kind of like in paragraphs. When you make a paragraph in like an essay you're doing, you don't always write to the end of the line. Sometimes you stop at the near the beginning of the line because you finished your sentence of that paragraph, and now you're at the new paragraph, so you skip to the next thing. And the rest of the line is blank. That's exactly what we have here in the scroll. They did the same thing. They tried to divide it into sections or paragraphs. So there's a blank there in line 18, and then we have lines 19 to 23 missing. And then on the next page, page 58, we see for food, it says and for food. It's probably talking about a prophecy of Noah gathering food into the ark so that they would be able to survive. Then we see in lines 26 and 27, Enoch finished doing a little prophecy, and Lamech is saying now, and he gave, talking about Enoch, he gave to Methuselah, and then again it repeats it in the next one, Methuselah, his son, understanding, and so Enoch was teaching Methuselah, his son, he was explaining to him, and he was being instructed in wisdom and prophecy. And then it says to him that in every sea, so it's talking about how the flood, it's going to be in every sea, it's going to be a worldwide flood. 28, line 29, it says the Lord will give to him for an everlasting name. It's probably talking about Noah again, how he would have an everlasting name. Then in, let me see here, we go to column 4 now, and I also could not reconstruct this very well at all, so I just read from what we have here. It says, they will cause much trouble, it says for all ages, much in the evil, and lines 4 to 10 are missing. And then it says, it seems like Enoch is talking, or perhaps Enoch is talking in the name, you know how the prophets talk in the name of God. So page 40 or page 59, he says, I decided to enact judgment and justice upon. That might be him talking in the person of the Father, saying that God is saying he decided to enact judgment and justice upon the earth by sending a flood. He's going to send a flood to enact judgment and justice. That might be what it's saying there. You see also in line 12, it uses that term again, Great Holy One. Again, that's all throughout the Book of Enoch. And let's see here. Okay, column 5. Now, I believe I was able to reconstruct this very well, perhaps not perfectly. Now I'm going to read from my reconstructed version. So follow along. In it's page, at the bottom of page 59, page 40, it says column 5. So follow along there, and when you see I get to line 7, then go to the next page immediately so you can just follow along as I read my reconstructed version. So, let's see. Alright. He wrote all of them in the scroll as a remembrance, all the words which Enoch had revealed unto Methuselah. And Enoch said, Now to thee, Methuselah my son, I shall reveal the truth to thee concerning the paternal origin of this child. For when I, Enoch, prayed to God concerning this matter, it was revealed to me that this child is not from the sons of heaven, but from Lamech thy son has he been born. As to why his son had such a marvelous and glorious birth, and in resemblance he is not of the sons of men, but is in the resemblance of the sons of angels, and as to why he spoke as a man and not as an infant, shall I reveal to thee. Because of the marvelous and glorious manner of the birth of Lamech's son and his appearance, thy son Lamech was afraid, and also from his speaking as a man and truly praising the Lord, truly trusting that he is God. Now I am talking to thee, my son, and making known to thee all that thou hast asked about. Then in truth will he be known. Go say to Lamech thy son, the child is truly from thee, and not from the sons of heaven, and not from a stranger, and his elevations on the earth, and every act of judgment I will entrust to him. For he has called out to me from his heart, and he lifted his face to me, and his eyes shone like the sun, and filled the entirety of thy house. This happened because this child is a light, and he shall bring rest to the earth, and through him his three sons shall be saved and their families, and the seed from a stranger shall not be found amongst the refuge of thy son. His name shall be Noah, for he shall be left to thee. He and his sons shall be saved from destruction, which shall come upon the earth on account of all sin and unrighteousness. Then they will be ensnared and destroyed who are not of Noah's people, and the destruction that shall come will be consummated forever, giving according to their impurity unto its limit. But after that there shall be still more unrighteousness on the earth, and they shall be doing much violence, that they will act until the second consummation in this manner. And they shall sin worse than this generation, and they will boil over in every path of violence they will walk, and they shall go astray from all my commandments and statutes. And now I am making known to thee, my son, the mysteries of the holy ones which I have known, and to Lamech thy son make known by this mystery all that the Lord has shown me and informed me, and I have read in the heavenly tablets what will be in his days. And look, and see all which the Lord is doing through thee, and know that thy son Noah shall be blessing the Lord of all in all his ways. When Methuselah heard all the words which Enoch spoke unto him, he left Parvaim and returned unto Lamech, and he spoke of Lamech his son of the mystery which Enoch had found written in the heavenly tablets concerning his son. And when I, Lamech, heard all the words which my father Methuselah spoke unto me, all the words which Enoch spoke unto him, I was rejoicing that from me the Lord of all had brought forth a son. And that's where that book ends. So you see, that's an amazing book. There was so much greater detail than what we have in the book of Enoch of this story. And that gives you a little taste of how much we're missing. Enoch had many more prophecies that are not in the book of Enoch. And he prophesied of Noah's purpose. And Lamech finally realized, because of Enoch's authority and prophecy, that Noah was truly from him. He was truly the father. And he was given an explanation. Why was he so glorious? Because it was a sign of his messianic role, in a sense. Not messianic role, but his role as a savior to the earth. That's why he came out as glorious. It's an amazing way to end the book. Lamech, when he was writing this, it's like when you read a good book, beginning and an end, and it like really ends at the perfect spot. That's exactly what we have here. We have Lamech ending the story with everything being good, and now he doesn't suspect his wife anymore. Happy ending. You know, it's great. Rhonda, the link you were trying to share is blocked from other people seeing. I think you have to take away the HTTP thing. But yeah, you can find me on YouTube, Onia Carlson, but if you can't find it, just message me on Facebook and I'll just send you the link. But now, if you guys are still following along, I'd like you to be on page 61. Okay, 61, page 61, and at the top it'll say page 42. And you're going to see there something really cool. It says in line 29, a copy of the book of the words of Noah. And in line 28, there's a blank space. There's a blank space because it's separating the two different books. Because they're two different books, so there's a line, there's a space there to separate them. So do you guys see that? That's page 61 and 42. And it says a copy of the book of the words of Noah, line 29. So this is very significant because it tells us, okay, now this is an actual copy of the book of Noah. This is not, you know, another book, but this is really what Noah wrote. So now we're going to see, it's amazing. Noah's book starts from here, this column, and goes all the way to about column 17. And then it's the ending of Noah's book is missing. But all throughout is fragmentary. Unfortunately, it's very fragmentary. So we have to try to fill in the missing portions. But enough survives in the scroll and also in the Book of Jubilees and the Book of Genesis that we can fill in those missing portions, a lot of them. Not all of them, but we can have a very good filling in of that story. So let's see here. I'm going to read from my reconstruction again. Let's see here. So lines 30 to 36 are missing. So please turn to the next page, page 62, and it'll say column 6 at the beginning. It starts from the top. It says from infancy. And so I'm going to read from my reconstruction the line prior and just follow along with me. And I was able to reconstruct a good amount of this beginning portion of the Book of Noah. So here's what I have. And the Lord did choose me for great things and was with me from the very beginning, because I was a light of goodness from infancy. And through the uterus of she who bore me, I burst forth for uprightness. And when I emerged from my mother's womb, I was planted for righteousness. All of my days I conducted myself uprightly, continually walking in the paths of everlasting truth. For the Holy One had instructed me to walk in the ways of the paths of truth, and to keep myself away from the highway of deceit, which lead to everlasting darkness, and to consider whether I would follow the Lord. So I girded my loins in the vision of truth and wisdom, in the robe of supplication, and in my youth I sought purity, and I abstained from all the paths of violence. Then I, Noah, became a grown man. I held fast to righteousness and strengthened myself in wisdom all my days. And when I, Noah, was 498 years old, I sought for me a wife, and from Rechiel, my father's brother, I went and took Amzerah, his daughter, as my wife. And she conceived by way of me, and gave birth to three sons and also daughters. Then I took wives for my sons and from among the daughters of my brothers, and my daughters I gave to the sons of my brothers, according to the custom of the eternal statute of marriage that the Lord of eternity gave to humanity. During my days, when there was completed for me, according to the calculation by which I reckoned, the begetting of my sons Shem, Ham, and Japheth in 10 jubilees, afterwards the time of my sons taking women for themselves in marriage came to a close. And the Lord of heaven revealed himself to me in a vision. I looked and was shown and informed about the conduct of the sons of heaven, and how all who are dwelling on the earth would be destroyed for their sins, even the sons of heaven. I hid this mystery within my heart and did not make it known to anyone. And the Most High sent one of the Holy Ones upon me, and the Great Watcher for me in commissioning, and by an emissary of the Great Holy One upon me, he warned me, and he came to interpret for me the vision, and his will he revealed, and he spoke with me in a vision. He stood before me and said loudly, "To thee, O Noah, was I sent from the Most High to come to thee in order to be an emissary of the Great Holy One. To me a voice proclaimed words of thee for thee, O Noah. Behold everything that is done on the earth." And everything was brought before me. So I considered all the behavior of the sons of the earth. I understood and saw everything they did. All the inhabitants of the earth increased exceedingly in injustice, and in vileness they succeeded. And they chose among them whatsoever they desired. And all the Nephilim and the sons of the earth were incited to fight each other for 2 weeks. Then was sealed up the sword of war, and the four great holy ones, Michael, Sariel, Raphael, and Gabriel, were bearing witness to the blood that the Nephilim had poured out. I was silent and waited until one of the four great holy ones took stones and stoned the sons of heaven and gathered them and bound them and cast into the abyss all the holy ones, who being with the daughters of men corrupted the earth and all who inhabit it, causing uncleanness by the divinatory arts. And I approached one of them, and he said, To thee, O Noah, was I sent to warn thee to hide thyself. All things that thou hast seen, be considering and examining of them. And I saw that hardness, obscurity, and condemnation were allotted to all the Nephilim and the sons of the earth who had sinned with them. But I, Noah, found grace, prominence, and justification in the eyes of the Lord of heaven. Wickedness was multiplied in the earth and corrupted the people perpetually, and the blood of the afflicted, the Most High, who sits on the throne in the highest heaven, grieved over. And they ascended the lamentations of the souls of those who were crying and making their suit unto the gates of heaven, which the King of all ages heard, and he was very angry, and there was condemnation for man, and for cattle, and for beast, and for flying creature, and for everything that moves on the earth. For all of them corrupted their ways and their orders, and every service and every imagination of the thoughts of mankind's heart was only evil continually. And then, so that's my reconstruction so far. I'll stop there for a second and fill you guys in on some of these things here. So you can see my reconstruction there is very faithful to the context, and it fills in the story in a way that seems like it's exactly what it's talking about. And I was able to reconstruct that using my understanding of the context as well as other books that have parallel ideas. I use Genesis, for example, in certain parts. But so let's look at some of this. For instance, it says, he starts out talking about how he chose righteousness in his youth. He had a choice between righteousness and wickedness. When he was a young man, he was given that opportunity, just like all of us are given. Are you going to be righteous, or are you going to be a wicked person? Are you going to follow the law, or are you going to follow your own path to sin? And he chose to be a righteous and pure man, and to seek God's wisdom. In line 7, it says, he took Amzero in the, let's see, what does it say? It says in this translation, Amzera. Amzera. This name, once again, is in no other book except in Jubilees. In Jubilees, it says the same thing. It says, let me see here. One second. So, okay. Jubilees 4:28 says, from earlier, it says, And in the 15th Jubilee, in the 3rd week, Lamech took to himself a wife, and her name was Batinos, the daughter of Barachiel, the daughter of his father's brother. And then later on, it says, And in the 25th Jubilee, this is Jubilees 4:30, verse 33, it says, And in the 25th Jubilee, Noah took to himself a wife, and her name was Amzera, the daughter of Rechiel, the daughter of his father's brother, in the first year of the first week, of the fifth week, excuse me, and in the third year thereof, she bare him Shem. In the fifth year thereof, she bare him Ham, and in the first year, in the sixth week, she bare him Japheth. But so right there, we see Jubilees is corresponding exactly with the book of, Jubilees is corresponding exactly with the book of Noah here, and the book of Lamech. It's not a coincidence. They are key, and they're, you can't understand one without the other. They both complement each other. And now, here is something really cool. It says in line 23, if you look, column 6, line 23. Well, let me see, what page is that? That's page 46 or 65. And you'll see there it says, "But I, Noah, found grace, prominence, and justification in the eyes of the Lord." In Genesis, it says the same thing, but it's much shorter. It says, "But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord," or the eyes of God, or Yahuwah, whatever. So we see Genesis is shortening the original version. It's summarizing it. It just says, "Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." But Noah, so the writer of Genesis was actually copying the Noah book, but making a shorter version of it. And so Noah, in his own words, he was longer, and he said, "I, Noah, found grace, prominence, and justification in the eyes of the Lord." So we can see that Genesis' story and account is derived from the book of Noah. And there's many other examples of this where it's derived from it. Second here. Okay. So now I'm going to continue reading. So basically what I have is a reconstruction of using Genesis. I'm pretty certain the command to build the ark had to go here. So I basically copied it word for word from Genesis. Okay, so I have it where here it says, "And the Lord said to me, I will blot out man whom I have made from the face of the ground, even man with beast, and moving creature with flying creature of the sky, for I am grieved that I have made them. An end of every flesh has come before me, because the earth has been filled with injustice by them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth." And then it goes on talking about how to build the ark. And then he says, "I will establish my covenant with thee, and thou shalt enter the ark." This is my reconstruction from Genesis. "Thou and thy sons and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. And from every life and from every flesh thou shalt bring pairs of all into the ark to keep alive with thyself male and female. And it shall be from the flying creature after its kind, and the beast after its kind, and from all which is creeping upon the ground after its kinds, pairs of all shall come into thee to keep alive. And thou shalt take to thyself from all kinds of food which is eaten, and thou shalt gather to thyself, and it shall be for thee and for them to eat." So now we're at column 7, okay? So turn to column 7, that is page 66, and you'll see at the top, line 1. It says, "You shall rule over them." But I think, you see where it has brackets? When it has brackets, that means sometimes the scholars are not 100% certain it is actually that word. So most of the word "rule" is bracketed, which means it's very possible that the word should not be "rule," but something else. So I actually reconstructed it differently than how they rendered it in that PDF file. So I'm going to read the reconstruction I did of the little bit, a few lines. The first 9 lines of column 7. So it says in my reconstruction, "And in every land the waters of the flood will flood over them, the earth and all that is upon it, in the seas and in the mountains and in its wildernesses. And the earth will destroy all life, assisted by every heavenly body, the sun, the moon, and the stars, and the watchers will induce them, and the waters will be prepared and begin to rise up now and throughout this entire year, flowing copiously and changing their activity, and great commotion shall they cause on the earth, and the earth will be completely destroyed on account of wickedness. But for thee and for those with thee, from all of them will I make for myself a new creation, and you shall be blessed and saved. For all thy righteousness thou dost deserve honor, and I am paying to thee my reward, so that thou shouldst be glorified for thy righteousness' sake. And after these words I woke from the dream I had been given from the great Holy One, and I rejoiced at the words of the Lord of heaven, and I cried out to my God, praising him and lauding him that he chose me for the preservation of the world in all things. And with amazement I glorified him concerning this revelation that he had given me, and concerning the wisdom he diligently taught me and testified to me. And the Holy One said to me," and now here's where I stop my reconstruction, because now I'm not sure how to fully reconstruct this. But so now we'll see. It is second here. It is page 66. It says, until they proclaimed the blood. And then on the next line it says, he will render this pure by the blood upon. Yes, it's amazing. It's an amazing scroll, amazing manuscript that was found in the scrolls. And then it says, to all humanity through you. This is an angel talking to Noah, saying, all humanity through you, Noah. So, assuming he's going to save all humanity through Noah, he'll preserve the lineage. And then, let's see here. Then it says, branching off, which he sought, and who will force him to, then the beautiful one immensely, then the heavens very much, and the ends of, then it says, to assist me and to build. Right there, that's a key thing. In the Book of Enoch, it says that there were angels who actually were building the ark. So it sounds to me like the angels were sent to assist him to build the ark, from what the Book of Enoch says, and that's what it sounds like Noah's saying here. He says in line, it's line 19 on page 67, to assist me and to build. He's clearly talking about the ark here. And then he says, what I dreamt. So he had a dream. This was actually from what he was receiving. The message was from a dream. And then Noah says, so I blessed the great Holy One and the insight. Hold on a second. Yes. And now we see Noah says, and I, and then every deed of, and then spoke with me and made known to me and revealing all, and then and their sons and the assembly of, like, all this stuff is not in Genesis. It's not in Jubilees. It's much extra detail that we're missing. But basically, in the missing section here, just to give you a understanding of the, as I said, the beginning and end of the Book of Noah is confined, the basic size of it is preserved in the scroll. So we know about how big the Book of Noah is, amazingly, because the scroll preserves a transition. It preserves the exact place where the Book of Noah begins, and it also preserves the approximate place where the Book of Noah ends. So we can see, okay, the Book of Noah had to be about this size, and then each of these columns we can map out and say, okay, so now we know this column here, and that's the whole Book of Noah. It gives us an outline of how much space we can fit for the Book of Noah's story. So using that, I was able to show or determine for myself that column 5, the beginning of column 5, talks about Noah's birth, his youth. Column 6, Noah's growth and Noah's family and Noah's secret vision of instruction. Then in column 7, it's vision of instruction from God to build the ark. And column 8 is instruction to take into the ark. Column 9 is the final words of God to Noah before entering the ark. Then the flood begins in that column. Column 10, the flood finishes. Then Noah makes atonement for the earth. And then God blesses them. And then column 11, Noah surveys the new earth. Covenant with Noah is made. And the command to not eat blood in that column. And then column 12, the rainbow is God's sign in the clouds, and then Noah again atones for the earth, and then Noah makes wine, and Noah has a special dream vision. And then column 13, column 14, and column 15 are all Noah's dream vision. And then, and also column 15, he talks to his sons about his dream, and then he instructs his children. And then column 16 would be Noah's children seek living places, and then the vision of the earth is done by Noah. And then in column 17, the division of the earth by Noah continues. Then the rest of the Book of Noah was the final days of Noah and protecting themselves against the demons. So that's the overview of the Book of Noah. And so That's what we can see based on the Genesis Apocryphon, what was preserved, and then also Jubilees. Comparing the two together, we can see that was the structure of the Book of Noah. And so, where we are right now is column... We were just reading through column 7, and we pretty much finished column 7. And as I said, column 7 was about his vision of instruction to build the ark. So now we're going to move on to column 8. And it says, I reconstructed the line before, just the one line before. Second. Okay, I said, and they went into the ark by pairs, its mate after it, male and female of every flesh. So that's the top of column 8. So we're seeing the story of them going into the ark. Then later on in that line it says 16. Now what does 16 mean? It seems to me that it's very likely that it's talking about the 16th day of the month. Because remember, the flood came on the 17th day. So 16 seems to be referring to the 16th day of that month. So the day before the flood came. And then, let's see here. And then you see in line 4, so on page 68 we are now, line 4 talks about forever, and then line 9, and throughout the entire flood, then you by the good King of Heaven, so it's addressing Noah still, by you and with me, and verse, line 16 says, in your week. I haven't figured out what that means yet, your week thing. I still have to determine that. Line 18 corresponds with that week thing. It says, and according to its week, and a written account, which, and then line 19, it's week. Line 20, and about 3 weeks. So maybe it's saying in 3 weeks the flood would come or something. Well, there's the parable of the weeks in Book of Enoch, but it sounds like what it's saying here, it might be talking about actual weeks, possibly, or maybe talking about sevens, some type of sevens, I don't know. Line 16 says, in your week. So it's possible that's corresponding with what Enoch says, because Enoch in the Prophecy of the Weeks says the week of, the 10 weeks, and in one of the weeks was Noah's week. But because it also says there's 3 weeks, and about 3 weeks, its week, according to its week, I don't know, so it might have a double meaning. There might be multiple meanings of the word week here. But so it's a little unclear based on the fragmentary nature, but we're seeing clearly a much greater detail. Then we see it's Yahuwah talking, or an angel. In line 31, it says, in a garden, and then it says 32, take for yourself and for your... So he's supposed to take into the ark, taking things into the ark for the preservation of his family and the animals. The next line says, to your sons after you for all. So it's preserving it for the next generations. And then it says, do not fear and do not go. So he's saying, you know, you might be afraid of what's coming, but don't fear. Just obey and you'll be safe. Don't worry. And then Noah says, then I went. So we assume, okay, here's where Noah goes into the ark. That's what it seems like. Or maybe he didn't go into the ark yet. Maybe he went to take stuff for him into the ark. But so we're really close now to when he enters the ark and the flood's about to come. The next page, page 70, it says, your father. And then line 2. And he... It says, all he will not save, and then it says, to you, and I am giving this authority to you. It sounds to me like he's basically telling him, Noah, I know you love your father, Lamech. But I'm not going to save him. He's going to die in the flood. So he's basically telling him ahead of time he's not coming with you. Because he mentions your father. That's what it sounds like he's saying. Now, some people incorrectly think that based on the Masoretic text in Genesis chapter 5, that Methuselah was the longest man who ever lived. He was the man who lived the longest number of years, 969 years. But that's actually not true. In Jubilees and in Samaritan copies of Genesis, they actually say that Methuselah was much younger, like more like 700s or 600s or something like that. And Lamech, Methuselah, Lamech, and Jared all died in the same year, in that year of the flood. So it seems like they all died. Perhaps they didn't die in the flood. Maybe they died shortly before the flood. And God decided to have them die, because there's other books which speak of those three men saying their goodbyes to their family and dying before the flood came. So to reconcile that, it seems like they all died in that year, but they died before the flood waters came. And so this contradicts the Masoretic dating that most people follow. But the Dead Sea Scrolls follows this Jubilee Samaritan dating method, not the Masoretic text. It was the Masorite scribes, the regular Hebrew copies, have altered Genesis to do a different chronology. Perhaps they altered it as to oppose these writings, possibly. We don't know exactly why they changed it. But so he was being told here about his father. That's what we see. So that's giving greater detail. We see that Noah is being instructed fully about what's going to happen. And then look at page 70 still. It says lines 11 to 37 are missing. So in those lines was an account of the flood. That's where the flood would have been told, and it would have followed the same basic story as Genesis and Jubilees, with perhaps a little bit extra details. But for the most part, that missing section follows almost exactly what Genesis and Jubilees says. So we're not missing too much there. Then we go to column 10. And now when we start at column 10, the flood is already over. He says, then I bless the Lord of all who from me, and he says, and kept safe. Then to Noah, words, all of them. Now we go to page 71. And let me see here. But he's still in the ark. So then he's being told to come out of the ark. So then I went, he says, then now go, and it says, and give praise and glory for the Creator. We got line 9, all of you to your Lord and to the King of all ages forever and ever unto all ages. And it says, then was on the earth, and he took from, finding for in the water. At the end of line 12 it says, the ark rested on one of the mountains of Ararat, and the eternal fire, there's something missing there. But now, we see, Noah says, and I atoned for all the earth in its entirety. To begin, the he-goat was placed upon, and it says first, and after it came upon, and then, and I burned the fat upon the fire. Second, and then a little bit later, it says, all of their blood to the base of the altar, and I poured out, and all of their flesh I burned upon the altar. Third, I offered the young turtle doves with them upon the altar, their blood and all of them upon it. I gave fine wheat flour mixed together with oil containing incense as their meal offerings. Then it says, portion of, and it said, I said a blessing and was putting salt on all of them, and the scent of my offering rose up to the heavens. Then the Most High blessed, probably he was being blessed for atoning for the earth. Let me just get a drink of water for a second.
Hold on.
Now, in Jubilees, it has the same extra details which are not in Genesis. The details of his atonement for the earth. So I'll read from where it speaks of it. So it says, yeah, I've got the bottled water, spring water, because I don't like all the stuff in the tap water. So I try to avoid it as best as I can. So this is from Jubilees chapter 6. And it says, and on the new moon of the third month, he went forth from the ark and built an altar on that mountain. And he made atonement for the earth and took a kid and made atonement by its blood for all the guilt of the earth. For everything that had been on it had been destroyed, save those that were in the ark with Noah. And he placed the fat thereof on the altar. And he took an ox, and a goat, and a sheep, and kids, and salt, and a turtle dove, and the young of a dove, and placed a burnt sacrifice on the altar, and poured thereon an offering mingled with oil, and sprinkled wine, and strewed frankincense over everything, and caused a goodly savor to arise acceptable before the Lord. So that's Jubilees confirming the extra details. So Genesis is not there. It doesn't have those details, but it has those details in Jubilees and in this book of Noah. Then we see in column 11 on page 72, column 11, Now I, Noah, was at the door of the ark, the springs receded. So he's still in the process of, he's still kind of visiting the ark sometimes, and still having them get out. He mentions his son in line 5. Some context there, I'm not sure. He's my son, then he says their sons, and he says all of them. Now line 9 is referring to Noah is going to be shown all the land, or he looks at all of land to survey what happened and look and see, wow, it's all alive again somehow. So he says, so it's the mountains and the wildernesses, the hinterlands and the coastlands, all. Line 10, it says four. I'm not sure what that means, four. Refers to something. Then line 11, then I, Noah, went out and walked throughout the land, through its length and through its breadth. And then line 12, upon it, rejuvenation in their leaves and in their fruit. The entire land was full of grass, herbs, and grain. Then I blessed the Lord of heaven, whose praise endures forever, and to whom is the glory. Once again I blessed the one who had compassion on the land, and who removed and obliterated from it all those doing violence and wickedness and deceit, but rescued the righteous man, he's talking about himself, then one, and he obtained all for his sake. Then he says, appeared to me from heaven, speaking with me and saying to me, do not fear, O Noah, I am with you and with those of your sons who will be like you forever. Then like a word's missing, and it says, be fruitful and multiply and fill the land. Rule over all of them, over its seas, and over its wildernesses, over its mountains, and over everything that is in them. I am now giving to you and to your sons everything for food, that of the vegetation and herbs of the land. But you shall not eat any blood. The awe and fear of you, and there's some missing that says forever. Now, I'll stop there for a second. This is really amazing because this corresponds almost word for word with Genesis, but it's longer, and there's some things in a different order. So let me go there again, or let me pull up the passage. One second. I'm going to read from New King James of Genesis here.
Let's see here. Second. Okay. So here
we have, so compare this, guys, compare this. So in Genesis, it says, so God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be on every beast of the earth, on every bird of the air, on all that move on the earth, and on all the fish of the sea. They are given into your hand. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. I have given you all things, even as the green herbs. But you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. So I'll stop right there. So take a look. It's in a different order. You see it? It says, so it starts off saying, do not fear, O Noah. I am with you and with those of your sons who will be like you forever. And be fruitful and multiply and fill the land. Rule over all of them, over its seas and over its wildernesses, over its mountains and over everything that is in them. I am now giving to you and to your sons everything for food, that of the vegetation and herbs of the land, but you shall not eat any blood, the awe and fear of you. So look, in the book of Noah, it says first, I am now giving to you that for food, and then it says immediately after, the awe and fear of you will be on the animals. In Genesis, it says it reversed. It says, the awe and fear of you will be on them, and then after it says, and I'm giving you everything for food. So there was a switch there for some reason. So this just shows us that Genesis is actually not preserving the exact conversation that happened. It's a shortened, reworked version that Moses did, and the scribes kind of altered some things too. But so basically, Genesis is preserving the reworked version, the shorter version, and sometimes it's told in a little different order. Right, it's the same information, but with more. There's more details in the Scroll of Noah. There's not a contradiction, it's just different order and a fuller text. We get the fuller message. So we don't want to be deceived into thinking when we read Genesis or some of the other books, when it's quoting someone, that that's what they actually said. It's very likely that the quotation is just a shorter version of a longer passage, which they condensed into a small little thing to just preserve the basic essence of their message. If someone had like a huge speech or sermon of, you know, not committing adultery, someone could shorten that sermon into like two or three lines and quote the guy as if it was in their speaking. But clearly, the two or three lines is not representative of his speech. That's not what he said. But the condensed version conveys the same information. And so that's oftentimes what happens in scripture, is when writers are quoting others, they're quoting the essence of what was said, not necessarily the exact wording. So that's important for us to understand. Because a lot of people put too much importance in the actual words used in the Torah and in other books. But since we see that those words used in the Torah are actually a interpretation or a shortened version of the fuller words and fuller conversation that these men had, then that's just, it just helps us to be accountable to proper interpretation of scripture and not to make too much of the certain words used. Now, continuing in the scroll, go to page 74, and now column 12. You see it says, see, I have now placed my bow in a cloud. It has become a sign for me in the cloud in order to be. So this is clearly the same thing Genesis is saying. But when you look at the size of how many lines are missing, this passage must have been much more detailed and much longer information about the covenant, about the sign. And so it just shows us that we're actually missing a good amount of material from the story of Genesis. even Jubilees. Jubilees does not preserve the full story either. So we're missing quite a lot. But the Noah scroll here gives us a good idea of what we're missing. So it's very significant for us studying the scripture. When we're studying Genesis, we want to study Genesis in the context of the book of Noah, from what we can glean from it. Line 7 in column 12, it's on the same page, says, on the mountains of, and then Ararat, and then a little bit later, on the mountains of Ararat, after this I went down to the base of this mountain, my sons and I, and we built a city, or perhaps it shouldn't say city, because it's, they've bracketed it there, but something like a word or two is missing, and then it says, for the devastation on the land was great. I think it's probably talking about maybe an altar they built. And then it says, then sons and daughters, then sons and daughters were born to my sons after the flood. To my oldest son Shem was first born a son Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. And all the sons of Shem altogether were Elam, Ashur, Arphaxad, Lud, and Aram, as well as 5 daughters. The sons of Ham, Cush, Mitzrayim, Put, and Canaan, as well as 7 daughters. The sons of Japheth were Gomer, Magog, Madai, Yevan, Tubal, Meshech, and Tiras, as well as 4 daughters. So you see something there. So here's what it says. Shem had 5 sons and 5 daughters. Ham had 4 sons and 7 daughters. Japheth had 7 sons and 4 daughters. Do you see what's going on there? It's clear that they're pairing up. So the sons of Shem intermingled with their sisters, the 5 sons, the 5 daughters. So they married their sisters. The sons of Ham and the sons of Japheth, they intermarried because it was a perfect combination. The 4 sons with the 4 daughters, the 7 sons with the seven daughters. So I think the reason that happened was more to indicate to emphasize how Shem's line is more holy and pure than the other lines. Because it's strictly within Shem's, the 5 and the 5. Whereas the others kind of mix together. So it just, that's how I make of it. It's just a sign that Shem was different than the other two. Let's see. Now. Then line 13, it says, then I, along with all my sons, began to cultivate the earth. I planted a great vineyard on Mount Lubar, and in 4 years it produced abundant wine for me, and I brought forth all of the wine. When the feast came on the first day of the first month, which is in the first month, and then in my vineyard and inside of my vineyard I opened this vessel and began to drink from it on the first day of the 5th year, after the planting of the vineyard. On that day I called together my sons, my grandsons, and all of our wives and their daughters. We gathered together and went, and it says, the altar. I was blessing the Lord of Heaven, the Most High, the Great Holy One, who saved us from the destruction. I'll stop there for a second. Okay, now I'm going to read from Jubilees, the corresponding passage, because this, again, is some extra details not in Genesis. So it says in Jubilees, in chapter 7, and in the 7th week, in the 1st year thereof, in this Jubilee, Noah planted vines on the mountain on which the ark had rested, named Lubar, one of the Ararat mountains. And they produced fruit in the 4th year, and he guarded their fruit and gathered it in this year in the 7th month. And he made wine therefrom and put it into a vessel and kept it until the 5th year, until the first day on the new moon of the 1st month. And he celebrated with joy the day of this feast, and he made a burnt sacrifice unto the Lord, 1 young ox and 1 ram and 7 sheep, each a year old, and a kid of the goats, that he might make atonement thereby
for himself and his sons. And he prepared the kid first, and placed some of its blood on the flesh that was on the altar which he had made, and all the fat he laid on the altar where he made the burnt sacrifice, and the ox and the ram and the sheep, and he laid all their flesh upon the altar. And he placed all their offerings mingled with oil upon it, and afterwards he sprinkled wine on the fire which he had previously made on the altar. And he placed incense on the altar and caused a sweet savor to ascend acceptable before the Lord his God. And he rejoiced and drank of this wine, he and his children with joy. And it was evening, and he went into his tent, and being drunken, he lay down and slept, and was uncovered in his tent as he slept. So I'll stop there. So it preserves the same story. Once again, Jubilees confirms the Book of Noah. Now, you saw in both the Book of Noah and the Book of Jubilees the reference to 4 years. He waited for the fourth year and then the fifth year, and that's when he started drinking the wine. Now, why did he do this? The reason he did this is because of Leviticus chapter 19 tells us in the Law of Moses, verses 23-25, when you come into the land and have planted all kinds of trees for food, then you shall count their fruit as uncircumcised. 3 years shall be as uncircumcised to you, shall not be eaten. And in the fourth year, all its fruit shall be holy, a praise to the Lord. And in the fifth year, you may eat its fruit, that it may yield to you its increase. I am the Lord your God. It's from the Law of Moses. Now, many people believe that that law only applies in the land of Israel. However, in Jubilees, which is actually quoting, Jubilees quotes a lot of stuff from the Book of Noah that's missing. So in Jubilees, which is quoting from the Book of Noah, it says, this is Noah's words, and now my children, chapter 7 still, and now my children, hearken, work judgment and righteousness, that ye may be planted in righteousness over the face of the whole earth, and your glory lifted up before my God, who saved me from the waters of the flood. And behold, ye will go and build for yourselves cities, and plant in them all the plants that are upon the earth, and moreover, all fruit-bearing trees. For 3 years, the fruit of everything that is eaten will not be gathered. And in the fourth year, its fruit will be accounted holy, and they will offer the first fruits, acceptable before the Most High God, who created heaven and earth and all things. Let them offer in abundance the first of the wine and oil, first fruits on the altar of the Lord. Who receives it, and what is left, let the servants of the house of the Lord eat before the altar which receives. And in the fifth year, make ye the release, so that ye release it in righteousness and uprightness. And ye shall be righteous, and all that you plant shall prosper. For thus did Enoch, the father of your father, command Methuselah his son, and Methuselah his son Lamech, and Lamech commanded me all the things which his fathers commanded him. And I also will give you commandment, my sons, as Enoch commanded his son in the first Jubilees, while still living, the seventh in his generation. He commanded it and testified to his sons and to his sons' sons until the day of his death. So right there, we see that Noah tells us that these laws apply in whatever land you're planting, not just in the land of Israel or the Promised Land. So this explains why Noah was doing this. He was following those laws of the fruit. The fruit had to be circumcised before he could eat it. And the circumcision of the fruit took 4 years, and then in the fifth year it was okay for anyone to eat. Now, here comes a very amazing part. Remember in Genesis, where it says in Genesis and Jubilees that Noah, he drinks wine and becomes drunk. And the way people interpret this story, as Noah sinned by being drunk, or maybe he didn't sin, but he was drunk, that's how people teach the story, because that's what Genesis seems to say, that he was drunk, and the whole story seems strange. Like, after he wakes up, then he wakes up and suddenly somehow knows what Ham did to him. But then instead of cursing Ham, he curses Canaan out of nowhere, even though Canaan didn't do anything to Noah while he was sleeping. It's a very bizarre story in Genesis. It's not really explained well at all. But in the Book of Noah, it's explained very well. And it has a very different twist revelation of what actually happened in the story. And I'm going to explain, after I tell what happened, I'm going to explain how Genesis is actually mistranslated, and that the mistranslation conveys a false understanding. So basically, so here's what we have. After Noah was obeying the laws of the wine, and then he was celebrating a festival, a holy feast, and drinking wine as commanded on the holy day. He drank enough wine so that he was very tired, because wine always, the more wine or alcohol you have, the more sleepy and slow you feel, and tired. So he was tired, and he decided to sleep. And he was so tired, he didn't even bother to cover himself. He lay on his bed and just fell asleep while he had not covered himself with a blanket yet. And so here's what Noah says in his book. He says, I'm not sure what he's saying here first. He says, this is page 76. Please turn to page 76. He says, which my fathers hid, I'm not sure again what he's talking about, but then in line 19, he says, by my righteousness. He says, by my righteousness, and I lay down upon my bed and fell asleep. Then he says, pure. And so right here we see two things. He says, by my righteousness, and he says, pure. It sounds like he's trying to say he was righteous and pure, and he did not do anything wrong. But now he's going to sleep, and now we see, I, from you, who, then the Most High God, line 22, I stirred, so he's sleeping and he's stirring now. He's disturbed in his sleep. Line 23, which I, Noah, line 27, every year on, so I'm not sure what some of this information is, but once we go to column 13, we see that he's now having a dream, a prophetic dream. Column 13, it only has the one line on this page. So let's go to the next page. And that is page 77 or page 58. And look at right there. Are you guys there? If you are, please look and see how it gives an amazing account of a dream, a prophetic dream. It's trees. He's prophesying of what's going to happen through the trees. And so it says, for example, it talks about the wood, then line 8, the birds of the heavens, the wild beasts of the field, the livestock of the soil, and the creeping things of the dry ground, going, line 9. The stones and the clay objects were chopping and taking of it for themselves. As I continued watching, the gold, the silver, the iron, and all of the trees were chopping and taking of it for themselves. As I continued watching, the sun, the moon, and the stars were chopping and taking of it for themselves. I kept watching until they brought to an end the swarming creatures of the earth and the swarming creatures of the water. So the water ceased, and it ended. That sounds like it's talking about the flood. And it says, and I turned to see the olive tree, and how the olive tree had grown in height. This continued for many hours, and with a bursting forth of many branches, good and beautiful fruit, and appearing in them, I was pondering this olive tree, and the great abundance of its leaves. And then he says, in line 15, everything and tying ropes onto it. Now I was very greatly astonished over this olive tree and its leaves. I continued staring in amazement until... Then, in line 16, the four winds of heaven blowing powerfully and violently against this olive tree, knocking off its branches and breaking it to pieces. First, a wind swelled up from, and it says the west. It struck it, caused some of its leaves and fruit to fall from it, and scattered it to the winds. And after this, and it says in a northern wind, then some of its fruit. And then a lot of lines are missing, like 15 lines are missing, 21 to 35, they say. Then we see in column 14, now his vision is over, and now an angel is talking to him and explaining to him. He's interpreting to him what he saw in the dream.
He says, "You were contemplating the wood, an upper part being knocked off from," and he says, "all the boughs and all the fruit of the foliage." And it says, "We know. Look." And then line 9. Yeah, this is now, we're on page 79. It says, "Now listen and hear. You are the great cedar tree that was standing before you on top of mountain, on top of mountains in your dream. And the shoot which emerged from it grew high and was rising up to its height. Three sons." So it's talking about his three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Then it says, "And as for the fact you saw the first shoot adhering to the cedar trunk, note 2, the one division branching off and the wood from it, says, now the first son will not separate from you for all his days, and among his seed shall your name be recalled. From his division all your sons, the first son shall come forth as a righteous planting for all." Then it says, "standing fast forever." So he's clearly talking about Shem being faithful to him and not abandoning him. But Shem's line would be the line that would be his posterity, his righteous line. And it says, "As for the fact that you saw the shoot adhering to the trunk," and then line 15, "as for the fact that you saw the branch of the last shoot," which, and then the next page, page 80, "the darkness and part of their bow entering into the midst of the bow of the first one, two sons," and it says, "one to the south of the earth and one to the north of the earth. As for the fact that you saw part of their bow entering into the midst of the bow of the first one," and it says, "of this shoot were settling in his land in all the coastlands to the great sea and not," and then they settled in the midst of the coastlands. So basically, he's being given a prophecy that the posterity, remember how the land was divided to his sons. There was land, he said, okay, here's the land for Shem and his children, here's the land for Ham and their children and his children, and here's the land for Japheth and his children. According to Jubilees, what happens is Canaan, one of the branches of Ham, or the shoots of Ham, he goes into the land of Canaan, which belongs to Shem. So violating what was belonging to Shem. And then also Japheth goes in Shem land as well. So we see here that Noah's dream was prophesying of this thing that was going to happen in the future. He was prophesying of Canaan, what Canaan was going to do, the sin that Canaan would do, and basically the history of his future generations. It says in line 19, "to comprehend the mystery, there will be for you an end." Then line 20, "entering into it, in the first one." And it says, "for himself, their every god," which, so it sounds like it's talking about they're apostatizing into idolatry or something. Line 21 says, "in an allotment in Amania, next to Elam." Then it says, "the great sea." These words you'll see later on in the book of Noah are the allotment. Basically, in Jubilees and in the book of Noah, it gives the exact details of which land was for which person. And it goes through and says these exact place names. Amania, Elam, Great Sea. It goes through that. So we're seeing Noah is being told that these place lands, he's being told prophecy about who's going to take these lands for themselves against what was allowed for them to do. Let's see here. And then, now go to column 15 on page 81. And it says there, like line 7, it says, "the merciful one," 2, and then line 8, "from them a profusion of wrongdoing and settling in your land." So it's talking about they're settling in his land. And then it says, line 9, "the ends of the earth. And as for the fact that you saw all of them crying out and turning away, the majority of them will be evil." So he's having a prophecy of the future of them sinning and
of the last days, it sounds like. He says, as for the fact that you saw, then he says, the great warrior coming from the south of the earth, sickle in hand and fire with him. He has crushed all. So perhaps this is an angel, or maybe even God himself coming to enact judgment. Okay, Sean, you have to go. The rest will be recorded. We might be ending it very soon anyways. But so you can listen to the rest on YouTube. Thank you for attending, Sean. I appreciate it. At the very least, I'm going to finish the Book of Noah in this teaching. I probably won't be able to do the Book of Abraham this time. So we'll just stick with Noah for now. So let's see here. And then it says in line 11, and the mighty Lord, he is the one who will come from the south of the earth. So it sounds like it's saying, you know, in line 10, the great warrior coming from the south of the earth. And then line 11 says, the mighty Lord, he is the one. So that's an identification there. It's telling us who it is. And then line 12, the torches and the evil one, and he threw all the rebellious ones onto the fire. So it's judgment, punishment of the wicked. So he's having a really, like, in-depth prophecy of the future. And it says, and they will seal. And then line 13, as for the fact that you saw, they plucked up. And now, page 82, it says, a chain on them, four mighty angels. Who are the four mighty angels? We know from Enoch, the four angels are the four chief archangels. Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, and Sariel. And they chain the wicked, bind them. It says in line 15, for them a chain from all the peoples of the earth who will not have power over. Then line 16, the agitated one because of their conduct, their inadvertent error, their wavering on account of much blaspheming and their fruit. Line 17, such that he may couple this people to himself. He will cut out a great mountain, and from it he will consecrate and separate between. This really sounds like the Book of Daniel when it talks about being cutting out a great mountain or a great stone or whatever. So there's a lot of similarities here. Line 18, between all the peoples, and all of them will be serving them and getting entangled. And then now the dream finishes and says, the angel that's talking to him says, you, Noah, do not be amazed at this dream, and may there not be added upon it. And line 20, I have related everything to you in truth, and thus it is written concerning you. Line 21, and I will join some of your people to you, and then to you. Then we see the dream ends now. He says, then I, Noah, awoke from my sleep. The sun rose, and I, Noah, and says, to bless the everlasting God. Then a little bit later, we see he's talking to his son and told him what happened and how the dream he had. He says, I went to Shem, my son, and related everything to him. And I think he's telling his son, Shem, about how the prophecy said that you, Shem, would be my holy and righteous seed. So he's informing Shem about this. And line 24 on the next page, 83, to take for yourself the Most High God. So we see here that this was an amazing dream, but none of this is even hinted out in Jubilees or Genesis. And yet it's essential, because this explains how he knew that Canaan, what he was going to do and why he cursed him, and how he knew that Ham had done this. Because in his dream, he was told, Ham mocked you. That was what he was told in his dream. So it just filled this Noah scroll just fills in so much of this story. As for why this is not in the Bible, Melissa asks, it's a very complex issue, but one of the reasons is it eventually became lost. It wasn't translated, and no one knew about it anymore. It was completely vanished. But one of the more important reasons why is because it was one of the Apocrypha books, one of the secret books. So that these books were, the Book of Noah was intended to be shared with only those who were holier than others and more worthy to see it. The priests had access to all these books, and the priesthood did not want to share all these writings with everybody.
So they kept a close grip on these writings. And then in the first century, when the temple was destroyed, many of those books were destroyed. And those weren't translated into English, or not English, Greek, or other languages. And not being translated, no one could preserve them anymore. So many of the writings just got lost through that way. And we had no access to this book until 1948, when this scroll was found. So it's really amazing the knowledge we get from this. Now I want to explain about the drunk part that I said. Basically, this word for drunk, in other places in the Bible, they don't translate it as drunk, like in one place in Genesis. Instead of translating it as drunk, they translate it as, "and the sons of Jacob were merry." So instead of translating it as drunk, they translate it as merry. M-E-R-R-Y. So how can you translate in one place drunk and in another place merry? You're clearly implying that in the place where it says merry, that they're not drunk. Because you would have translated it as drunk if you believed they were, and that's what it was saying. So it shows that the translators understand that there's a greater meaning to the words sometimes, but that they're picking and choosing which meaning this word is in that passage. So when they translate it as Noah was drunk, that's an assumption on their part and not necessarily the case according to the Hebrew text. And the Apostle Peter, and he had teachings to Clement. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with that book. It's the Recognitions and Homilies of Clement. And in that book, the Apostle Peter tells Clement and says, "I don't believe anything that's evil about the righteous men of God." Basically, the men were righteous men of God were righteous. They weren't unrighteous. So if the scriptures portray the righteous men as being unrighteous, then that's a corruption of the text. You can't be righteous if you're unrighteous. And so Peter explains some examples. He says Moses was not a murderer. He did kill someone, but he wasn't a murderer. People interpret and impose that interpretation into the text. So he explains, no, he wasn't a murderer. Then he goes through other sins too and says, the patriarchs did not do this, they did not do that. And one of the things he says is, he says about Noah, he says, Noah was not drunk. So if that was truly written by Peter, which I believe it was, said by Peter, then I agree with his reasoning. And he said that Noah was not drunk, and since the Hebrew can be translated in a different way, it doesn't have to be translated as drunk, then we can trust that and know that Noah was not drunk because in his own book, in the book of Noah, he's being blessed with a prophetic dream vision, and he was drinking wine as a holy and righteous activity on the holy day. And then then Noah himself talks about him being righteous. He says, "I was righteous," or something. So it seems to me, with all that evidence together, that we can trust that Noah was a righteous man, and he did not do that sin of drunkenness. And now, so what I'm going to basically do is just finish this Noah thing. There's not much left here. And I'm not going to do Abraham this time, because there's a whole thing of Abraham's scroll. I thought we might have time for Abraham's scroll, but as always, it goes much longer than I thought it would, because there's so much to cover. So if you guys want, if you really like this teaching, and you want to go through for the next one, you can either read it for yourself, or you can also listen to what I have to say in next teaching about the scroll of Abraham. So we'll finish that one next time, but I'll finish Noah's now. So now we're missing a lot. We're missing some lines, and then we're in column. We do this once a week. We go through and study something once a week. Sometimes we study a book of scripture, or other times we study just topics in general. We ask questions. People ask questions, and then I answer from the perspective of the Dead Sea Scroll faith. I converted to the Dead Sea Scroll religion in 2011. Not from the Book of Enoch group. She just, Laura, I think it was, she had shared the link to the to the Book of Enoch group. I actually have another group, the Dead Sea Scroll community group, and that's where we host the events there. I'll add you. And yeah, so we do this once a week on Sundays. We try to do it. We try to start at 8 p.m. And we've done already 16 in the past. This is number 17. I did Book of Giants in a teaching long ago, but it wasn't from the series that we're doing. So I'll probably be covering that again in the future. But yeah, we did cover Giants in the past, like a year or two ago, through other studies we did of a teaching. We have it on recording, but I don't know where the recording is. It's somewhere on my computer. Let's see here. So sometimes the scholars, when they're trying to reconstruct the scroll, they don't realize that there's a missing column or there's a missing thing. Because sometimes, so imagine this. Imagine you've got one column here and one column here. And then there's like a line down the middle. And then the scholars look at the two columns. They're separated from each other and they say, it looks like these fit. If they fit, that means this was connected to this one and this one immediately came before this one. However, it's very possible sometimes that it seems to fit, but it's actually not a perfect fit, and they don't realize that, and they're incorrectly fitting it together. So in my view, they're doing that here, and there's an extra column, an extra one or two columns here, or in the previous column, which they are missing. They didn't realize that there is there. And so now we are in column 16 on page 83, and we see that Noah is talking about the division of the land for his children. So it says, like line 9, of the sea that is between them, the source of the Mehak, up to the Tina River. It then passes as a spring the length of the whole land of the north in its entirety, until it reaches source of, and up to the land, line 11 on page 84. This boundary line crosses the waters of the great sea until it reaches Gedera, and then says, and Noah divided by lot from Japheth and his sons to receive as an everlasting inheritance. So that first part starts with Japheth's division. Then, now we go to Shem's division. Line 14, for Shem emerged the second lot, for him and his sons to receive as an everlasting inheritance. It says, the waters of this river, Tina River, emerge as a spring up to the Tina River, then the Mayota Sea, which reaches then the Gulf of the Great Salt Sea, and this boundary goes as a spring from the Gulf, and then up to the Gulf of the Sea that faces toward Egypt. It says, until it reaches the allotment of, now let's see here, going to the next page, page 85, line 26, and for Ham there emerged the third share, to inherit for him and his sons, everlasting, talks about the Gihon River, now column 17, says in line 5, to Meshech and the sons of, that's Japheth's line. Then line 7, and Shem divided his portion among his sons. There first fell to Elam in the north along the waters of the Tigris River until it reaches the Ephraim Sea to its source, which is in the north. And after him to Esher toward the west until it reaches the Tigris. And it says, and after him to Aram, the land that is between the two rivers, until it reaches the peak of Mount Ararat in that region. And after him to Lud, then says, fell this Mount Taras. This portion passes to the west until it reaches Magog, and everything along gulf that is by the eastern sea. In the north, adjoining this gulf, that which is above the three portions to its south. For Athakshad, and then which turns to the south, the entire land irrigated by the Euphrates, and all. And it keeps going. You see all this stuff, the different details. It says, line 15, the portion that Noah his father divided for him and gave to him. And then line 16, and Japheth divided among his sons. First he gave to Gomer in the north until it reaches the Tina River, and after him to Magog, and after him to Madai, and after him to Javan, all the islands that are all alongside Lud, and between the gulf that is next to Lud. And so it goes through it. And then line 22, the sons of Noah divided their allotments. And so now the rest of the book of Noah is gone, and we don't know what the ending was according to the Noah scroll. According to the scholars, there was one column, and now we're already we're now in the scroll of Abraham. I don't believe that's possible. There's not enough space. So this proves that the scholars incorrectly reconstructed this, and that there's an extra sheet that's completely missing. A sheet has something like 5 to 7 columns. So we're missing like a sheet, which should be in between here, and which had the conclusion of the scroll of Noah. And I'm going to read now from Jubilees the missing sections. Not everything, but I just want to read to you guys to show you what the scroll of Noah is connecting to, and that's it for this teaching. So let's see here. Noah in Jubilees. One second here. Okay, so it says in Jubilees chapter 8. Well, you asked, is he a rabbi? Who are you talking about? Unfortunately, the Dead Sea Scrolls are fragmentary and damaged. But what we have is amazing enough to help us restore much of the lost understanding of the ancient faith. So it says in Jubilees chapter 8, verse 8, and in the sixth year thereof she bare him son, and he called his name Peleg. For in the days when he was born, the children of Noah began to divide the earth among themselves. For this reason he called his name Peleg. And they divided secretly amongst themselves and told it to Noah. And it came to pass in the beginning of the 33rd Jubilee that they divided the earth into 3 parts, for Shem and Ham and Japheth, according to the inheritance of each. In the first year, in the first week, when one of us, that's an angel, one of us who had been sent, was with them. And he called his sons, and they drew nigh to him, they and their children, and he divided the earth into the lots, which his 3 sons were to take in possession. And they reached forth their hands and took the writing out of the bosom of Noah their father. And there came forth on the writing as Shem's lot, the middle of the earth, which he should take as inheritance for himself, and for his sons for the generations of eternity. And then it goes through and says all the inheritance for Shem. This is in Jubilees. So this is corresponding exactly to the book of Noah. It's not in Genesis, but both Noah and Jubilees go through the land allotments in detail and says this land was allotted to this and this to this. And then it goes in great detail. The same places are mentioned. And verse 17 of Jubilees, it says, this portion came forth by lot for... let me read in the previous verse. It says, and it extends towards the east until it reaches the Garden of Eden, to the south thereof, to the south and from the east of the whole land of Eden and of the whole east. It turns to the east and proceeds till it reaches the east of the mountain named Rapha, and descends to the bank of the mount of the river Tina. This portion came forth by lot for Shem and his sons, that they should possess it forever unto his generations forevermore. And Noah rejoiced that this portion came forth for Shem and for his sons, and he remembered all that he had spoken with his mouth in prophecy, for he had said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and may the Lord dwell in the dwelling of Shem. And he knew that the Garden of Eden is the Holy of Holies, and the dwelling of the Lord, and Mount Sinai the center of the desert, and Mount Zion the center of the navel of the earth. These 3 were created as holy places facing each other. And
It says, and he blessed the God of gods, who had put the word of the Lord into his mouth, and the Lord forevermore. And he knew that a blessed portion and a blessing had come to Shem and his sons unto the generations forever, the whole land of Eden. And so then it keeps going. So basically, we have here more details about what the Noah scroll said in this section of the allotments. So we can use Jubilees to reconstruct the missing portions of the Noah scroll. So after it's divided to the three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, then those three sons decide to divide their land to their children. So Noah divides the land to the three sons, and then the three sons divide it to their sons. And so everything's divided, everything's explained, who owns what for an eternal inheritance. And after going through all the information in Chapter 9, verse 14 of Jubilees, it says, and thus the sons of Noah divided unto their sons in the presence of Noah their father, and he bound them all by an oath, imprecating a curse on every one that sought to seize the portion which had not fallen by his lot. And they all said, so be it, for themselves and their sons forever throughout their generations, till the day of judgment, on which the Lord God shall judge them with a sword and with fire for all the unclean wickedness of their errors, wherewith they have filled the earth with transgression and uncleanness and fornication and sin. And now I'm going to read this final section, because this, even though it's not preserved in the Noah scroll because it's too fragmentary, this is the end of the book of Noah. This, we can know for certain, this is how the book of Noah ended. Chapter 10 of Jubilees. Only the first, 15 or something verses. Says, and in the third week of this jubilee, the unclean demons began to lead astray the children of the sons of Noah, and to make to err and to destroy them. And the sons of Noah came to Noah their father, and they told him concerning the demons which were leading astray and blinding and slaying his son's sons. And he prayed before the Lord his God and said, God of the spirits of all flesh, who has shown mercy unto me and has saved me and my sons from the waters of the flood, and hast not caused me to perish, as thou didst the sons of perdition, for thy grace has been great towards me, and great has been thy mercy to my soul. Let thy grace be lifted up upon my sons, and let not the wicked spirits rule over them, lest they should destroy them from the earth. But do thou bless me and my sons, that we may increase and multiply and replenish the earth. And thou knowest how thy watchers, the fathers of these spirits, acted in my day. And as for these spirits which are living, imprison them and hold them fast in the place of condemnation. And let them not bring destruction on the sons of thy servant, my God, for these are malignant and created in order to destroy. And let them not rule over the spirits of the living, for thou alone canst exercise dominion over them. And let them not have power over the sons of the righteous from henceforth and forevermore. And the Lord our God bade us to bind all. And the chief of the spirits, Mastema, in other words for Satan, came and said, Lord, Creator, let some of them remain before me, and let them hearken to my voice, and do all that I say unto them. For if some of them are not left to me, I shall not be able to execute the power of my will on the sons of men. For these are for corruption and leading astray before my judgment. For great is the wickedness of the sons of men. And he said, let the tenth part of them remain before him, and let nine parts descend into the place of condemnation. And one of us he commanded that we should teach Noah all their medicines. And he knew that they would not walk in uprightness, nor strive in righteousness. And we did according to all his words. All the malignant evil ones we bound in the place of condemnation, and a tenth part of them we left, that they might be subject before Satan on the earth. And we explained to Noah all the medicines of their diseases, together with their seductions, how he might heal them with herbs of the earth. And Noah wrote down all things in a book, as we instructed him, concerning every kind of medicine. Thus the evil spirits were precluded from the sons of Noah. And he gave all that he had written to Shem, his eldest son, for he loved him exceedingly above all his sons. And Noah slept with his fathers and was buried on Mount Lubar in the land of Ararat. 950 years he completed in his life, 19 jubilees in 2 weeks and 5 years. And in his life on earth he excelled the children of men, Sev Enoch, because of the righteousness wherein he was perfect. For Enoch's office was ordained for a testimony to the generations of the world, so that he should recount all the deeds of generation unto generation till the day of judgment. So basically, Jubilees tells us this was the end of the Book of Noah, of the how the demons were trying to harm his sons, and Noah prayed for mercy that they would be bound, and he was going to do it. God was going to send them all away, but Satan intervened and said, you appointed me as the punisher of sin. You gave me that authority, and I'm telling you, if you send them all away, then there will be then we won't be able to punish sin. There won't be anyone to do that. So he said, okay, you're right, but I'm going to send 90% of them, 9/10 of them, and I'm only going to leave 1/10 of them with you, the demons. So the majority of the demons were banished, but 1/10 remained. This explains to us why in the New Testament there's still demons, because we know God has the power to send demons away, so why didn't he do that yet? He must want them here still, because if he didn't want them here, he could easily remove them. So we see that explains why, because they have a purpose still to punish the wicked. Just like the law of Moses speaks about blessings and curses. If you disobey the law, there'll be curses. And so he uses the demons as a way of punishing people and giving them for what they deserve for going against his ways. And so that, and then he wrote down, Noah wrote down in a book how to heal yourself using certain herbs from all these demons. But that's not preserved. So we don't know what it said, unfortunately. But so this is just a powerful, it really helps when we study Jubilees in the context of the Dead Sea Scrolls, we can reconstruct the basic content of the Book of Noah and other writings too. And that's pretty much it for the Noah scroll. Do you guys have any final questions? Or are you guys, let's see. Oh, and I'm not going to the Vero Yehad camp thing at the end of this month. But I might be doing a teaching there through Jackson's computer, possibly. So, and then next week, I'm going to probably continue, because this week I was hoping to do Abraham's teaching. And Abraham's teaching, I was going to go through Abraham's scroll. And Abraham's scroll is a good long thing, so I don't have time to do that this week. So I'll do Abraham's scroll next week for those who want to listen. But if you can't make it live, you can listen on YouTube, the recording for Abraham's scroll. And it was not the demons who taught Noah about the herb healing. It was the righteous angels who were sent. The angels were sent to bind all the demons, and then they were also sent to teach Noah the herbal healing medicines, and he wrote it all in a book. And then there's other books, like the Testament of Levi. Levi, the son of Jacob, actually wrote a book too. And in that book, he says Noah wrote a book. So there's a lot of evidence of a book of Noah. And Jubilees, all throughout Jubilees, you see Jubilees says Noah wrote a book. Then it says Abraham wrote a book. Then it says Jacob wrote a book. You see all throughout, and he says Enoch wrote a book. So it's clear from the context of Jubilees and comparing it to the Dead Sea Scrolls, Jubilees was derived from these writings and is endorsing them as scripture. The writer of Jubilees would not have used them if he didn't think they were authentic or real. And I believe Jubilees is authentic as well. That is, I believe, writing by Moses, and the angel was speaking to Moses. So that's the Noah scroll. I hope you guys enjoyed the Lamech scroll and the Noah scroll. Any final thoughts? Share now, and I can address the final things. But and then after, if there's nothing else for people to ask about, then we'll end it. So let's see here. Yeah, how long have we been doing this? No, I converted to the Dead Sea Scroll faith in 2011. I've been doing these teachings since
Like, I started doing some of them in 2014, but we didn't do this series. We didn't start this series that we're doing now until this, it was last year around the beginning of fall, around October. And so we are now at teaching number 17, weekly Dead Sea Scroll Bible study. We just did our 17th one today, and next week we'll do our 18th one. So, yeah. All right, looks good, guys. Thank you for so much for coming and listening to this whole thing. If you really like my teachings, listen on YouTube, and you can contact me on Facebook. I'll be there, and you can add me as your friend, and we'll talk about things. Well, you want me to answer this one question? I'll answer this question. Who is Jesus Christ? The question was asked. I believe he is the Messiah, the prophesied. And that he is Yahuwah, who came in the flesh to atone for our sins. That he's not the Father, he is the Son of the Father. He's begotten, and he has a beginning, but that his spirit is from eternity. And he's one with the Father in that sense. But it's a very in-depth question, very difficult to answer in such a short amount of time, but hopefully you understand. I do believe that he is the Messiah, and so I'm not a Jew in the sense of, you know, how the Jews, most of the Jews reject him as the Messiah. They don't believe he was the fulfillment, but I do believe he was the fulfillment. Of course, I believe in the law of Moses too, so I believe in Yeshua as the law. Anyways, so hopefully that answers the question. Thank you so much again, and we'll hopefully see you guys next week. Shalom to you all.